That name gets attention. A little fellow here today says, oh, I saw Garfield in the movies. Well, he's also in the funny papers, too, if you haven't seen that. Oh,
there we go.
Right. Praise the Lord. I want to share with you a scripture this morning, and it came to me while I was just meditating this week. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels. What a picture. We come dressed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. If you're not a Christian this morning, you can be clothed with the garment of righteousness. If you're not a Christian this morning, there isn't anything else you can do except receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Be thinking about that as the Word of God is brought to us this morning. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you we can come into this place this morning. Lord, you have blessed us so much with a place to worship, and you have blessed us, Lord, as you have filled this place with your presence. We ask once again, Father, that the Holy Spirit will be free to move as he will amongst us today. Father, quiet our hearts and our minds. Open our hearts so we may receive what you want us to receive today. Father, as we lift up our eyes onto the fields around us, we pray, Lord of the harvest, that you will send forth laborers into your harvest in this last hour, this 11th hour. Call them out, Father. Call them out, and they will respond. Send them forth, endued with the power from on high. And Father, thou hast said in the word, ask ye of the Lord rain in the time of the latter rain. Oh God, we ask for that latter rain, that outpouring of your Holy Spirit in these last days. We thank you for the places we've heard that are enjoying an outpouring of the Spirit of God. But Father, we are in desperate need here for the outpouring of your Spirit that will bring us conviction and repentance and restoration for what you wish the church to be. Father, we also remember our leaders this morning. Lord, we just thank you. God, we can see your hand is in the midst of it all. We also see the hand of Satan trying to destroy, to kill, to destroy. But Father, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And we come to you this morning in the name of Jesus. Lord, we're united with you. Lord, we are your children. We are sons of God. And Father, we ask with that authority that Jesus said, go in my name. So Lord, in your name, we ask that you'll stretch forth your hand. Quiet, O Lord, all this nonsense that is going on, this nitpicking, this hatred that is coming forth. Lord, we can see that not a bit of that is from you. But Father, we ask you to stretch forth your hand. Send, Lord, angels to go into their midst to bring confusion, that their evil intent will come to nothing. And Father, that you will, the man you have set in, Father, doesn't seem to me any question because it came so miraculously, that Lord, you will endow him with what he needs to do the work for which you have set him in there. May he be even a Cyrus or a Nebuchadnezzar, whatever kind that you can say, this is my servant. Father, we need your help in our country. We need the help in the church. So Lord, we're asking you to send forth the angels that are ministering spirits to those that are the heirs of salvation. Lord, we commit this service to thee today. Thank you again that we can be here. Lord, we're so glad to honor you and bless you and pray after this manner, as you said. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Ghost, and teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. So we're evangelists, but this morning I would like to kind of take my evangelistic coat off, if you would, and talk to the body of Christ this morning. And of course, salvation's always out front. You know, I say the three E's of what we seek to do is to exalt Christ, to evangelize the world, and encourage the saints. That's been our platform for all these years, because it's all about more and better disciples. We made a little card years ago of our ministry. People ask us from time to time about our ministry, and I have these little cards occasionally. I said the reason I've kept the original, because when you're young, you want to take a lot of pictures. But the message is the same, because God never changes. And what He commands throughout the Word of God is alive and well today. And He wants to speak it into every heart. Every heart, the divine order, will, and plan. He is the master planner of all life. Amen? And He has given us His Word. And whenever I was thinking about what I might talk about this morning and where we might go, and I never know exactly where we're going, but I know that God's given us a starting point here this morning. And that is found, if you would, turn with me in your Bibles to Psalms 11. Psalms 11 and verse 3. I'm going to read one verse this morning here, and then I'm going to move into the teaching that God's given me in regards to what we have for this message this morning. Psalmist David is speaking and in a song, in a proclamation, what it means to have faith in the righteousness of God. How many know we are in His righteousness? The Bible says there is a gift of righteousness, not of my own doing, but I have been made righteous through the blood of Jesus Christ. And we have eternal life. We have everything pertaining unto life and to godliness. And David is caught in a situation, and what made me think of this, and I think Brother Garfield hit on that this morning when he was praying or when he was speaking, whatever, and that is the condition that the world is in today. While we are out to be an instrument of God and a reflection of the image of the God and the kingdom of God, we have to be aware of the outside pressures that come upon us. And how much confusion, even Susie and I see it, in the eyes of the people that are incarcerated. Because seemingly, they're without hope in the world. That's what Paul said. You were one time without hope in the world. You didn't have a plan. You didn't have a blueprint of what God had in for. But God has given us a knowledge of Him, and He has given us eternal thoughts. What you think about concerning eternity will affect everything you do today, because it's in view of where we're going. We have an eternal purpose and an eternal plan, and when we tap into the eternal things of God, we begin to see all of the life around us from a different perspective. And when the world is in the situation it's in today, and I believe David was in somewhat that position when he was speaking in the 11th Psalm, when he declared that in the third verse, if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? There's a connecting scripture, if you got a cross reference in your Bible, probably gives it to you, and that's... That's in Psalm, I believe, Psalm 82. Psalm 82, and it says this: they do not know, nor do they understand. They walk about in darkness, and all the foundations of the earth are unstable. It's speaking of leadership here. And when there is not a leadership, or one that's leading the confusions that we're experiencing today, you know that the world is shaking. How many knows it? The world is shaken today. When you don't have leadership, and when you throw the covenants of God outside, and you don't use them as a plumb line of our country, then we are without hope and most miserable. And that's what we have today. And I believe is what David was saying when he began in his psalm. He said, "The Lord, I put my trust. How can you say to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountains? For look, the wicked bend their bows, and they make ready their arrows on the string, that they may shoot secretly into the heart. And if the foundations are destroyed." And I begin to look at that foundation and what it means in that sense right there. And what it speaks about is social foundations of right living. Whenever you take all the laws and you declare that God has no place in our government, we're not no longer a Christian nation, and we do not hold to the right living that David was talking about in the foundations. It was talking about the foundations of right living. And he says, if you've got them in that 82nd Psalm, he said, then you have a shaky situation. And we're shaky today. There's seemingly no hope. There's seemingly, apart from the Word of God and the kingdom of God, the world at large has no answers. They can't agree on anything. They have all the things sent out here and perpetrating the minds of people of fake news, and people don't know what to believe. They do not know what they can do and where they can run. And that's the way I believe David felt. And sometimes if we let the overseeing of all of the things that's going on, it makes you want to run. You say, where can I flee to? Well, I'll tell you where we can flee to. We can flee to the bedrock of God's Word and find a foundation of hope and power and peace in a time of trouble. And that's what God is speaking. We were created to have eternal thoughts and study the things of God in regards to our current situation. I know this last week, a couple weeks ago, we went down to see the Ark. Anybody ever been to see the Ark? And some of you have? Okay. Tony Rothrock and Marcia and Susie and I went down there. And on the way down there, Tony made a remark. He said, you know, I need to really study deeper about the Ark and what God spoke and the covenant that he made with Noah. And you know, my thoughts ran immediately to Genesis chapter 6 and to Matthew 24 when he said lawlessness will abound. You know that word in Genesis 6 where it talks about the conditions? That word is literally translated lawlessness. The same lawlessness that turned her back. And I began to tell, and Tony began to talk, and we were going to see the Ark, and we didn't drive but a few miles, and it began to rain. I said, well, we're going to see the Ark. That was the next phase in it. If you get the thing built, we're going to float the boat. And we did not, and I don't know when the last time I talked to Susie, when the last time I saw a rainbow. But you know, Tony didn't drive another few miles, and he said, look at that rainbow. I said, well, you said you wanted to learn more about it. I said, I think God sends you an object lesson here. He lets you know that the rains come, and the rainbow is a covenant promise from God that he's still in command and control. And when the world gets shaky, God's still in command. He's still the master plan. He still has all things into his power. And although the world is rising against us, folks, I'm here to tell you this morning that look up, that we have a promise of God from eternity that we will overcome, and we will be more than conquerors, and we will survive. We will float above the pollutions of the world because we have an ark of safety. And one of these days, as I told Tony, one of these days, God's going to close the door of opportunity just like he closed the door. But I'm telling you this morning, it's time to shout it from the housetops. It's time for us as a church to grow up in him and to be effective as a person and cooperatively as a body of Christ. that we can come to support one another in all the things that God has placed us here to do. And I believe this morning that what God wanted me to share with you is that we can look around us and we can see the foundation shaking. We can look around us and know that there's political uproar. And that's what it was somewhat in the case of David, because there was a political crash there, because Saul was seeking to kill him. And he was running. He said, "Shall I flee?" Because there was a conflict of powers. There was a left wing, right wing, if you please. And they and David began to see that Saul, though he was seeking to kill him, that the greater power that was within him might make him want to run, but he was looking at the foundations of his faith in Almighty God. You know, sometimes all we can do is just look at the foundation. We don't know how the wind's going to hit us. You don't know where the next wind's going to hit you. But we know one thing, that we have an anchor that's steadfast and sure. And with that thought in mind, let's go into the New Testament. But on our way in there, I want to say something here about the promises of God. Because when you turn away from God, and our leadership removes all things about God from them, they tear down the things that's been erected in God. And it says in Daniel chapter 11 and verse 32, "Those who do wickedly against the covenant, he shall corrupt with flattery. But the people who know their God shall be strong." Everybody say strong. We're strong in him, not in our power, but in his power. And it says, "And they shall do exploits." You know, that's a word I don't use very often. How many use exploits? I looked it up in the Strong's Concordance, and they didn't have any word on it. It was blind. I don't know how many's got a strong concordance, but they wasn't nothing. I thought every word in the Bible had some kind of description. So I had to look deeper into what God was saying as far as exploits concerned. And here's the message that comes from that word. It says to make full use of and derive benefit from a resource. Now listen, we're going to do exploits, but what it depends on, if we make full use of and derive our benefits from a resource of God and the things of God, the teachings of God, that he said teaching them all things. And we got to know today, Brother Jerry, how do we dig into the things? It's time, folks, to dig. It's time to dig deep into God and in the promises of God and the sayings of Jesus, because in the parables of Jesus is wrapped up the principles of God. And if we're going to know the principles and the things that governs the kingdom, and we are part of the kingdom of God, we're on this earth and God is our kingdom is up there, and we say, "Thy kingdom come," as they did in the prayer, "Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth." We are a kingdom of heaven, and we are an outpost. But he give us a governor to come down here called the Holy Spirit to govern this thing. And if we're led of him, and if we let the Spirit of God bring the teachings of Jesus and get application, we're going to build up into a holy and a spiritual house for Almighty God, giving ourselves to God and giving ourselves to one another. The whole commandments is laid on loving thy God with all thy heart, thy mind and soul, and your neighbor as yourself. And God wants to draw his church together to encourage one another, to bring to the plate whatever the gifting God has given you to serve in the kingdom. And the men of this church and the leadership of this church is here to help to build the church of Almighty God, to be able to serve against the wiles of the devil and the things of the world, that we can have a strong faith in a tough time. And we can do it. We can do it because God is our refuge and our strength. And through him we can do all things. Jesus had something to say when he said, "Teach them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always." You don't have to worry about the presence of God. He'll never leave you. You don't have to worry about getting out of his, because he'll never leave you. He's always available and approachable. He's always there. He says, call upon me in a time to call upon me, and I'll show you great and mighty things that you know not. He said, you have not because you ask not. We have to learn to come before God boldly, because the veil's gone. And the law put the veil back. But when you get rid of the law, you can walk into the presence of God. Because we're now in our great high priest. He didn't have to wait for another 12 months to go into the Holy of Holies to see if God was going to accept their offering or not. To see if the priest, high priest, was going to fall. No. We had one, and you know what? We're in him. And that's what Satan didn't know. Satan did not know that there was any way, when they guarded that tree of life, that mankind and sin that God couldn't look upon could ever stand in the presence of a holy God. What he didn't know, the blood of Jesus Christ that was sent as a seed, and we're born to that incorruptible seed, that we're in him and his blood, and when we stand before the Father, we don't stand in our own position. We stand in the righteousness of Almighty God's Son, and in him we have all things, and we can come boldly. And the devil will never want us to believe that we're ever good enough to come into God's presence. But I want to tell you there, we're not standing there in our righteousness. We're standing in there in the righteousness of Jesus right before the Father, because he's seated there living and reigning ever to make intercessions for the children of God. And we have a great high priest that's our mediator, he's our intercessor, and he's our advocate. He's our mediator because he cut a new covenant with the Father, and we're in him. And therefore we can go before the Father. Because we're in him, we don't go in. The flesh can't glory at all. It's done, it's set. But the spirit that we have in him goes before the Father. Because he has given us. And I begin to look at this. I begin to look at these scriptures that God began to lay on my heart. Let's read. Let's read in Luke, the 6th chapter. And the 46th verse. But why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Whoever comes to me and hears my sayings and does them. Everybody say, does them. You can know a lot about God. But until you come his way to do the things God's way, I knew a lot about God before I knew God. You can know God, a lot about him, but to know him in intimacy and know that his sayings that live in you is going to build a foundation of power that you can withstand every wind of the world that comes against you. And here's what he said. Whoever comes to me and hears my sayings and does them, I'll show you what it's like. He said, it is like a man building a house who dug deep. Say, dug deep. You don't get it on the sandy surface. You build it on the sand, it's going to topple. Whenever something comes down the road, adversity comes down the road, and the world looks like it's going to hell in a handbasket, and everything seems like, if you turn the TV on, it's just one slugfest after another. And you say, where's God in all this? I'll tell you where he is. He's in the life of the righteous, and they will be a remnant left on this earth when he comes back that hasn't bowed their knee to Baal. They have not given themselves. They have given themselves. They've remained it strong because they've went and do the exploits, and that means that they make full use and desire benefits of a resource of heaven. We're drawing from that fountain that cannot run dry. We've got the refreshing of the water of life running with us, and we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So dig deep and laid the foundation on the rock. How many say the rock? Boy, I love that song that Dottie Rambo wrote a few years ago. When I need a friend, I run to the rock. I run to the rock of my salvation. You know, that's one song that made it to Hollywood, and I think accidentally God slipped it in. Whitney Houston sung that in one of the top movies. I'm telling you, God's got a way of slipping things in. If you hear anything about Hollywood, it ain't going to talk about the rock of my salvation. I'll tell you that right now. I've heard some of them talk. And I never believed that I'd live long enough that the blasphemy that's taken force on Main Street today would be existent. That I saw a sign held up. If she would have aborted the baby, we wouldn't have this. If Mary would have aborted the baby, we wouldn't have had this mess. But I'm telling you this day that the baby lived. And he ever lives and reigneth to make intercessions for every one of us this morning. In him there's no variance. I'm telling you, when you call upon the name of the Lord, you open the windows of heaven and God is always, always on call. You never get an answering service. He's always on call. And when the floods arose and the stream beat vehemently against the house and could not shake it, for it was founded on the rock, on Jesus Christ and his sayings. That's what he said. I'll tell you what it's like when you do my sayings and you incorporate the kingdom into your life and you begin to respond to outside undeserved offenses toward that situation, and you take authority in the name of Jesus. Then you can say with a purity of heart, none of these things move me. Because there's a lot of places today, I'm telling you, to give up and run. That's what David said. He said, I won't run. Why? Because he had the principles and the foundation of his faith in Almighty God. That God, if you read on a few verses, God will judge a mess. All through the Bible, he said that God, he said, he'll take care of him. And when we see what Jesus commanded us to do, and then when I see that, the things of my sayings, I reflect back on all the things that Jesus said regarding the kingdom, all the things he said in the Beatitudes. Them are all part of the sayings. And all the things he told about when he gave the parables. He said, who's my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? He said, the greatest commandment of all. The church leaders ask him that. Priests and the Levites. He said, it's to love your God with all your heart. Jesus just asked him the question, what's the Bible say? He knew what the Bible said. You love the Lord thy God with all your heart and all your mind, so, and your neighbors yourself. But trying to be defensive of his doctrine, he said, well, who's my neighbor? He answered it with a principle of the parable of the Good Samaritan. What he said was, God's going to take people that's had failure in their life, that the church is outcast, and they don't want to really mingle too close with them because after all, they did that. But I want to tell you this morning that when he said there was a priest came and he walked by, and he looked and he proceeded. The Levite. But he said there was a Samaritan. That's the last thing they wanted to hear. They hated that group of people. They were half-breeds. They weren't fully Jew. They hated them. The last thing you, sometimes the worst thing a church wants to see is somebody walk through that door that's been through hell and high waters, and they got all the scars of sin on them, and they walk up here and they begin to preach the delivering power of God because they know it better than anybody in the house, and they know whom the God sets free is free indeed, and they have the power of God in their life. They will teach you something. And he said this Samaritan walked by and he had compassion. And he began to address these wounds and tie them. And the Bible says that he poured oil and wine. And then he took him and he set him on his beast. And he took him to the inn. And he said, if there's anything further needs to be done, I'll be back. Charge it to my bill. Here's my credit card. I want to tell you, in that principle, it depends on the love and compassion that's in our heart that's going to bring the wounded and the hurting. Because when he poured oil and he poured wine, wine represented the new cup, Jesus. The oil represented the anointing. He seated him together in heavenly places. And then he said, I'll return. He said, now who? Ask him now who is thy neighbor? He said, the one that came to the one that the thief who comes to rob, kill, and destroy, that's laying in the pits. That's some of the sayings. We're to observe to do and to speak the things pertaining unto God. I'm telling you this morning that we are a church and we're drawn together by the Holy Spirit. Anointing is for others. The first sermon Jesus preached, he took the word of God and he turned it to Isaiah 61:1. And he said, the anointing is upon me to heal the brokenhearted, set liberty those who are kept, open the eyes of the blind. And Isaiah 61 said, and to visit those in prison, those that's fallen through the cracks, those that the world don't want to hear about, those that the devil has wounded and left for dead. We as a church, as a body of believers, and a spiritual building with God, that we can be to them the sayings and do with them, we know we have a foundation, because the more you get involved with the kingdom service of God, that's greater your foundation. You get a faith that's beyond all imagination, because you know you've fought a good fight. You know you've kept the faith. You know that henceforth there's laid up for you a crown of righteousness. And Paul said, not for me, but all that are looking for his appearing. That included us. Because we're fighting, we're digging in. Sometimes that digging is to dig deep, and it's a lot of times it's to dig out of our lives the things that are carrying us and not bringing us the freedom. Amen? It can be all the things that Jesus talked about. All the errors of our life that God's trying to change. All the things that's mentioned in the Bible of the works of the flesh. Trying to get the works of the flesh so we can experience the fruit of the Spirit. He always says, this is where you was in the times past. You was alienated from God, from the commonwealth of Israel, blah, blah, blah. You was without God and without hope. But the next word is, but God, who's rich in mercy, has made us to be joint heirs with King of Kings. We are seated, folks. And that man had compassion on him. You know what? He showed him Jesus. And if we're going to be an image maker, our image is going to come from the building that we're erecting in the Spirit of God, one with another. Turn with me. Turn with me over to, let's see. I believe I wrote down 1 Corinthians. Yeah, I did. 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 9. This is how we build up a foundation of the facts of God. Listen carefully. We need to see ourselves from God's perspective. When I drove in here today, I saw a lot of fields. And I saw a building. And this is what God showed me. We've got a purpose in the fields and you got a purpose in the building. And here's what he said. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, the ninth verse of the third chapter of 1 Corinthians. You are God's field. You are God's building. According to the grace. Somehow for a long time, a lot of churches, legalistic people teaching, couldn't use that word very strong. But it's according to the grace, and by his grace, he saveth. I heard John, and I believe in grace, but I want to tell you something. Anything that abuses grace is not of God. I want to make that clear. I'm not into this thing to tell you a person go out there and say, I love Jesus and live for the devil. It won't work. The Bible said they went out from us that it might be made manifest. They were not of us. Had they been in us, they no doubt continue with us. But it happened according to a dog to his vomit and a hog to his wallow. They may go in and be pretenders for a while, but don't let everything that's named Lord will enter the kingdom of heaven. But he that doeth the will of the Father, and if we don't see him, and a man comes or a lady comes, and they don't change and their life doesn't change and they're going back to the vomit, they went out from us that it might be made manifest they were not of us. Jesus said, many will come to me in that day and say, haven't we done? But he's going to say unto them, depart from me, ye workers, I never knew you. So we don't want to confuse that when people are living in sin and calling it greasy grace, because there ain't no such thing. You use that term, there ain't no grace, it's greasy, I'll tell you that. It's the power of God, and you're either in it or you're out of it. But everything that glitters is not gold. You buy a ring and you have to wear it a little while. If you buy it at the 10-cent store like we used to, it'll turn your finger green. But you wear it a little while to know what's pure and what isn't. So not everyone that says, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. All right. Now we are a field. And he uses agriculture. And then he uses architect. Because when you get Jesus' teaching, he'll teach you very quickly and plainly in Mark chapter 4 that the seed, if you understand this, you'll understand all the principles, parables. If you understand that one. He said it's like a man that went out with seed and sowed it. And some fell on stony ground. Some fell on the different soils. But some fell on good ground. That's why we're the field. Take care how you sow. Take care of how you handle the seeds of God. Because I want to tell you, the things of God will produce 100-fold. But he can't get it to you. Because of hardness and because of things in our lives, it's dispelling to the production of that seed. But I want to tell you, it's the seed of Almighty God is powerful, but it's pure. Scientists will tell you the only seed that they can discover can't be hybrided or it can't be grafted is a mustard seed. If you have the faith, it don't have to be much. It has to be pure. Because you can't come and approach God on a hybrid faith. You got one hand in the world. You got one. You got to come boldly and sincerely and submission unto God and his presence of power in order to God. God can't work through that stuff. If he did, he'd have to go back and apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. But he's the God that changed not. So let's read here. How much more time I got, Brad? Susie, when are you going to tap the watch? She usually does this. But in the third chapter, in the third chapter of 1 Corinthians says this, for we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field, and you are God's building, according to the grace of God which was given to me as a wise master builder. I have laid the foundation, and another builds on it, but let each one take heed how he builds on it. For no other foundation can any man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. The image of the people as a building under construction, it's a responsibility of the church leaders to understand that we are a construction site. We are attempting, and we receive the responsibility to be faithful to the part God gives us in the ministry of the gospel. That's why there's diversities of gifts and personalities and talents. But we all build on one foundation, that's Jesus. Our fellow workers, he said, take care how you build. And remember that if we build on this foundation, the only foundation, Jesus Christ, we're going to have different gifting, but different outworking. And just because you're not an evangelist, or you're not doing what some of the leaders of this church is doing, you're still a spiritual stone. And the church is responsible to place in the body according to the giftings. And the central ingredients in any work is love. And God showed me like this. When you got leaders and the leaders are fitting in the lively stones. When I built the first house, the brick came from a small brick place, not like they are today. They're all uniform pretty well. And they were very ununiform. So that meant it was hard to keep all of your width properly. But you know what I found out? It was that cement that bonded them together. It made it solidified the wall. If you'd have stayed them up there without mortar, Brother Jerry, they would have fell over. But it's the love that will solidify a building for God. But we got to stay focused on the foundation. I remember one time I was riding with my brother-in-law in his pickup. And he's a pretty big contractor. He builds hospitals and things like that. Not an easily built place, I guess. I can imagine all the wires that goes through it. But we passed this work site, and I looked over to this, and I saw one of his trucks. It said Striker Construction, and then it had the plastic around it, you know, retaining where they was going to move earth and things. And it kept sitting there. Didn't see any other equipment. Just saw the trailer and the plastic. And I asked him, I said, Donnie, what's going on there? I said, when are you going to start that project? He said, we're held up. We got a restricted building permit. And said, until we can divert this water, it's a watershed place. Until we can defer this water and take care of this water, we can't put a foundation in. It was a foundation built on a restricted building permit. And when I heard him say that, my mind went straight to 1 Corinthians 3. We have a master builder, but we are contractors. Take care how you build. And sometimes we got to defer the things out of our lives that'll destroy our foundation. And we've all had things in our life that we couldn't be fully honest with God. We might preach or we might go to work half a person because of the things in our life we knew wasn't right. But I want to tell you something. God's going to use people that's failed. You may feel that you started out with God and you failed so grievously that God can't use you now. And that's what I love about this church. I love a lot of things about it. Your love for number one. But they receive people and they use them in their fellowships. Don't matter what church you come from. Amen. I know Brother Brad's heart. Amen. And in some churches, they say there can't be too many cooks in the kitchen. Yeah. Yeah. But I know he'll fitly join you and together the men that God's brought into this place as contractors. Because we're under construction. We're all under construction. And God has put the leaders in this church to help us to become the right and have the right to grow spiritually and together. And this is what God is speaking to the church in spite of our outside influences. We can't let the outside influence control what's in us. We got to stay anchored. We got to dig deep. We got to have a foundation of fact that we can be ready to give a man account of the faith that lies within anybody that asks us. Because we have a foundation. We have something in us that's teaching us the things I say. And doing them. Putting them into practice in our daily lives where we go. Be a building. It's an image of the building that we stand for. And yes, we are individuals. But collectively, we are a church. Jesus saves us individually. But he places us in a corporate body. Not to beat that brother down. Not to say, well, after all, he did this. And I remember that he, you know, blah, 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 blah. You better forget that. Because whom the Son sets free is free indeed. I remember John Maxwell saying one time, he said he was raised in a works church. And if anybody's ever heard of John Maxwell, he's a pretty good leadership teacher. You see a lot of his books if you go into the Bible bookstores. John said, I went back to one of the old churches I grew up in, and he said, they're still cleaning the same fish they caught 30 years ago. We need to bring them in, and but we need to let God's Holy Spirit begin to deal with them on the things that they are and not throwing a shadow on what they did. Because I want to tell you, there ain't none of us in here that don't have a past. Every one of us. And if the devil can use your past to control your present and destroy your future, he'll do it. But I'm telling you, I know the pastor's heart. I know the heart of the leaders of this church. They are constructors, and they want to construct a house, a spiritual house. A house that's dedicated to God and his purposes. And we will grow up in him into a lively spiritual house. Because the Spirit of God is able to blend us together with the love of God and make us a solid rock and make our feet on the solid rock that we can withstand the wind and adversities that we all face. And we don't know how far this thing's going as far as our country. I don't have to stand up here and preach about what the country. We got some real serious global and also international problems. We need to band together in oneness, because the whole world, for that matter, is divided. Can't agree on a single thing. Say he's going to part his hair on the right side, that's wrong. You got to part on the left side. In closing, I'm going to close it, Brad. God told me, I said, God never give me sermonettes. I wish I had some of them sometime. But turn with me, if you will, and we'll close with this. In the second chapter of 1 Peter says this, therefore, and it just in the verses before it talked about withering of grass and how we're here for a season. The grass withers and the flower fadeth, but the word of God endures forever. And it says here, therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and evil speaking, as newborn babes desire the pure milk of the Word of God, that you may grow. Indeed, you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. And it says, coming to him as a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen of God, you also, having as living stones, are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifice acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. We are living stones, people. Spiritual stones. Let us come together. Let's allow the leadership, and I know they do on the regular basis, teach you how it means to walk in God and do the things that he saith, because we're out to win the world. And then to teach them all things. Amen? We want to grow close to God. And we want to love one another. It's the whole basis of the kingdom of Almighty God. Let us stand. I realize this has been a challenge to the church, but as an evangelist, everything revolves around receiving Jesus Christ, because if we haven't been translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the marvelous kingdom of light of the Lord Jesus, we cannot have the positional power that God has for us to be in Him and walk in Him and live in Him. But if you know you've been saved this morning and you know that God is speaking to you, He's kind of drew some things here that we need to really to stand back and look at the master plan. We need to walk it and then look at the master builder is wanting to build His kingdom in us and collectively as a church building. But if you're here this morning and you've never received Christ, maybe you just came in and you just are looking for something in a world of no hope, I'm going to tell you, Jesus is the hope of glory. He is the hope. We don't have to sorrow as those who have no hope. You don't have to walk out of here with confusion and wondering how you're going to face another day, because we see the storms of life are raging, and we need to draw nigh unto Him. We need to know that our anchor holds. We need to know that we have a place, that God has redeemed us and has made us brand new creations according to His word. We're not a rearrangement of our past. Our past is gone. Your sins and your iniquities, if you confess them, God, are gone. You got no right to bring up what somebody did last week. Because if you ask God what they confessed last week, He'll tell you one thing: I can't remember. And you better not. If you do, you're playing God. You're doing something God can't do. Well, yeah, He messed up. Well, I remember that preacher. He did this and that, and he's wrote up. You better forget that. Because God's going to pull them up, and He's going to use misfits as He has all through the Bible. David knew where his anchor was, but he was a mischarge in a lot of things. He was a womanizing murderer, having murder done. So don't think that our sins are held against you. They're not held against you no more. But you have the forgiveness of God's power, and not only will He forgive you, He will impute His power into you and translate you out of a kingdom of darkness into the marvelous kingdom of light of the Lord Jesus. And if you're here today and you need to be and know that you have an anchor that holds, we just ask you to come and receive Christ. Ask you to come and say, "Preacher, I need life. I need life. My life's a mess. I just need some hope. I just need a light here." And I'm telling you, He is the light of the world. And He won't shine it on your past. He'll shine it on your future. He'll shine it on your next step and upon your pathway, not where you came from. If you need Him today, you come. I know Pastor has already asked you to be prayed for with the various things that you had need of, and that's good. But I want to tell you today, you have a strong, strong leadership in this church that wants to help you grow. I know I've been here long enough, and I see it on your faces and expressions of love. Amen? Just bond together in these last days, because we need to know that our foundation is sure, that the winds of deception can't come against you no more, and your sins are remembered against you no more. Amen? Thank you so much for allowing Susie and I to come up here.
Praise you. We love you. You're going to be blessed in a couple weeks. My partner in Florida is going to come, and he's going to bless you. You're going to fall in love with him. Yeah, he's come out of the world. He's got scars to show it. But I want to tell you something. That man's a digger if I ever seen one. He's digging into the Word of God to be what God wants him to be. And you're going to be blessed. Amen? Amen. I hope you heard something today. If it's of God, I hope it is stamped indelible on your mind. If I said anything that's not in God's will, I hope you forget it before you get out that door. But I want God to be glorified, Pastor.